That's a big sign of hope. The God of angel armies is always by our side. Amen. Why don't you greet one another? We stand and continue to worship. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice.
Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the
Simple song, simple words, big, huge truth. How great is our God? Amen. We're going to do a new song called Good, Good Father. You probably heard it. Just a quick little story. I have never done this song in church. When I first heard it, it's like, why do they repeat good? You know, we weird people as song leaders have quirky little stuff of when we pick songs, right? So I just never did this song. So I never really listened to it. And a couple of weeks ago when I was at church in Florida, it's warm there, by the way, we did this song. And you know that movie where, forget the name of the movie anyway, it's got the famous line where you have me at hello, right? Oh. We started this song and it was like, hello. Why don't we put the first verse up there? I've heard 1,000 stories of what they think you're like. All the people have different, you know, whether they're for the faith or against the faith, they have their own picture of what God is or what God isn't, right? But, the next slide, but I've heard those tender whispers of love in the dead of night. I know, because I know that God is real, and I have my own experience, right? So it doesn't matter what everybody else says. It doesn't matter that they think it's hogwash or that you're, you know, some spiritualist weird person. I don't care, because I've heard the tender whispers. When I'm in deep trouble, I've heard it. I've felt it. I've experienced God. Next slide. I almost couldn't sing after this one. You tell me that you're pleased with me? Are you serious, God? You tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. Why? Next slide. Because you're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's God. He's love. He is who he is. Next slide. And why does he love me? Not because of what I've done. Not because I accepted him as my savior. Because he loves people that haven't. He loved me before I did. He just loves you because you're you. I said, okay, I got to do the song. So we're going to do the song. Beautiful start.
I've heard 1,000 stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're you its love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me.
Did I wait so long to do that song?
Thank you, Jesus.
Call me out upon the water, the great unknown. Where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name. Above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Sovereign hand will be my guide. Your feet may fail and fear surround me. You've never failed and you won't stop now. So I will call upon. Oh, trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the water wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the water wherever, wherever. Oh, take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Oh, oh, oh,
of God is a beautiful thing. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Take your Bibles, please, and turn to John chapter 10. We're studying through the book of John, verse by verse, and just walking through there. This is the 21st sermon in this area. And we're doing the first part of John chapter 10, and we're talking about two of the great I Ams that Jesus talks about. He talks about being the door and the good shepherd. And so that's the context. In your bulletin, there was sermon notes. And I'd love to have you fill them out so that you can look at them later and ponder. If you didn't get one, raise your hand, and one of the deacons would be happy to give you a copy of the notes. One of the questions I have for you is, when you were growing up, do you ever have your parents call you by some other name? Who had that happen? Yeah, it's actually pretty universal. And I remember my parents doing that to us as kids growing up, you know, and they'd start, if it was Peter, for instance, he's the baby of the family, but they would start with somebody, they'd call him David, and then they come down to Peter or whatever. But then I realized that we were doing it in our house. You know, I'd go to talk to Jim, and I'd start with Jim, you know, and then pretty soon, I could tell it was really bad when we start calling him by the dog's name, Skipper. You know, and there are some traits, some personality traits that are like our dog, quite frankly. And but I did get redeemed and feel better because John is doing it now to his three kids. And there is justice in the world, and I feel so much better with that. The whole name thing, and then you come to church and you try to remember people's names, or you meet new people and you're trying to remember their names, and it's like, how do I remember all these things? And I just want you to know that there is somebody who knows your name. And he never forgets. He calls you by name. And that is very significant. When we go to movies, we have a weird trait in the David Lynn family. After the movie is done, we stay there. And we watch the credits. And we go down and see how many of our names of our family are on that credit list. First names only. Anybody else do that? Thank you. Thank you. Martell family. So I get it. That's a weird thing. But we sit there and the whole place empties out and they're cleaning up. And we're still sitting there trying to see if we can get everybody's name. That's my wife's fault. She started that trait and now John and Erica do that too. The whole thing of names is really important. You go to graduation as parents, you know, and your child has spent either a year and younger or as they grow up in high school, 4 years, and then 4 years in college, and you wait for their name to be announced, right? And what do? There's cheering and hooting and clapping and all sorts of things. Well, I just want you to know that your name is really important. And there is someone, and his name is Jesus, and he doesn't forget your name. Let's walk through this particular text. It's John chapter 10. We're going to study verses 1 through 21. There's four basic principles here on this whole concept of names and how we have a specific need and Jesus answers it with a specific way. And I think it's really encouraging to know these things. So here we go. Number one, our need is recognition. His response is he calls us by name. We want to be recognized. We want to be remembered. Look at the first couple of verses. I tell you the truth. The man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. He's calling us by our name. Now, a sheepfold, we don't see too much of that because we're more into the beef and dairy here in this area. But in their culture, they would have a sheep pen where they would bring their sheep at night for protection. And because there are many caves in the area, especially in bad weather, they would bring the sheep and they would go into the cave. And then on the mouth of the cave, what they would do is they spread thorn bushes. So predators and other things would not come in to steal the sheep. In the residential areas of that area, they would take the side of the building as part of their protection, and then they would gather boulders around the other parts of it, and they would put more thorn bushes around. And in the freestanding country, they would just do that all the way around, and then they would have an opening where the sheep would go in and out. And at night, they would put rocks and then thorns there to try to keep things out. But they had two kinds other than the wild animals that were there. He says, there are robbers and thieves. The word, the Greek word for thief is klepto. Does that sound pretty familiar? Like the kleptomaniac? That's exactly where we get it from. And it's somebody who has a persistent impulse to steal. And they're just klepto, and they just take things. He says, there are people that do that to sheep. They take them. And then there's other people who are robbers, and they deprive others of their goods, and they'll use violence to deal with that. One of the big things in pastors' lives is what we call sheep stealing, quite frankly. It's taking people from one church, and they aren't yours. And you're taking them and taking them to your church. That happens. And over the years, we've gone through different phases of that, even here in Rutland. And we as pastors talk about that. And when you have people, and I'm not opposed to people visiting other churches, but there comes a point where who's part of the team? You know, how do you figure that out? And so you got to figure that out. And so we as pastors, there's a group of us pastors who will say, by the way, some of your sheep are over here. Might want to come and get them or talk to them or something like that. And we'll talk about it. We as pastors are shepherds of our people, and we will talk with other shepherds. It's kind of interesting. So our need is recognition, and God calls us by name. Now, we have trouble with the names that we remember and know. It says that God calls us by name. Does God not have any problems? And so what? There's this detail I put in here about stars. And I want you to see it. It says this. What about God's ability to remember names? In Psalm 147:4, it says this, and it's a fill in the blank. He determines the number of stars and calls each of them by name. And I said, okay, so how big is our God? And so here's the slide here. There's a number of slides that we could pick from. This is part of the coloring from the Milky Way. We are in the galaxy of the Milky Way. In our galaxy alone, and if you go out at nighttime, you'll see a whole band, especially across the middle of the sky, that is part of the Milky Way, and we're part of that bigger system. They estimate that there's 100 billion stars in our galaxy. Now, if you go out at nighttime, just with your own eye, you can see about 5,000 stars. They say you can identify about 5,000, and it has to be pretty dark, and it has to be pretty clear. But then the horizon cuts it off, and here in Vermont, it kind of cuts off even more. But so you only see half of it. So I guess you can see probably 10,000 stars with your own eye. But if you have some help, in our galaxy alone is 100 billion stars. Now God says he calls them by name. And I bet he doesn't make any mistakes. But then if you have really magnification and super help, they have estimated there are 170 billion galaxies like the Milky Way. Now multiply those two numbers together. That's what God remembers. And I'm thinking, that's my God that does that. He remembers all those names. So turn to also Isaiah 40:26. I love these kind of verses because it talks about the greatness of our God. God is really awesome. If you start in verse 25 of Isaiah 40, God is talking about himself, and he says, to whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? And then notice what he says. He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. So you got 100 billion stars in our galaxy times 170 billion galaxies that are in what is called visual space. It's what is observable by us. There are other galaxies you can't observe because they're hidden by galaxies in front of them. Or there is just of a particular magnetic wavelength that you can't see them visually. There are other galaxies too, but this is an observable space. Now, why did God do that? Does it make any sense? It's like a little overkill, isn't it? But that's who God is. He is a great God who does great and he put those up there for us to see. And when I stand out, and I do this every night when I walk in, because there's not a lot of lights where we live, and I go, wow. I'm real small, and my God is real big. And I am so privileged to know him personally. He cares about me, and he knows my name, and yours, and yours, and yours. I think that's amazing. Second is our need for guidance. And his response is, he leads us. The number one question I get as a pastor and as a leader is, what do I do with my life? Where am I going? What's my purpose? And that's a very fair question to ask. And I think we need to know. And it says here, he leads us. Notice at the end of verse 3, he calls the sheep by name and he leads them out. When he has brought them all, brought out all his own, he leads and goes ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said it again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate of the sheep. All whoever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. And so he's saying, listen, as a shepherd, I lead my sheep. The shepherd never drives sheep. In our culture, we're used to cattle drives, and they drive the cattle, and they have, you know, cowboys and that kind of thing, and they drive the cattle in a direction. You can't drive sheep. Sheep don't do that. You can't drive them. It's like pushing a wet noodle. You can't direct it. It just does its own thing. You can't drive sheep. You lead sheep. And I think that's pretty cool. God leads us. He goes before us. He says, come on, follow me. And he leads us in the paths of everlasting. We hear his voice. There's something about hearing a voice that you recognize that is amazing. And I sit in cultures over the many years, and I watch women when kids cry or do something that is obviously somebody's in trouble. One of the mothers responds and goes and deals with it. It's like, don't you other women hear it? They do. But it's not theirs. And so nobody else responds. It's like the one mom that goes and responds. I think that is so interesting that they recognize the voice, and there's this communication that goes back and forth. That they recognize the voice and they go deal with it. Our problem in this whole issue of guidance is we get so busy. We have so many things that we want to do. And I think in our culture, busyness is a badge of something. And I'm not impressed by busyness. Just because you're busy doesn't mean you're accomplishing what God wants you to accomplish. The question is, are you doing what God wants you to do? Are you really achieving that? Or do we say, not now, Lord? The third principle is this: our need is provision. His response is the abundant life. John 10, starting in verse 9. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they might have life and have it to the full, or have it abundantly. God's desire is that we have an abundant life. Not just a ho-hum life. Not just barely getting by. Not living life under the circumstances. What's that mean, under the circumstances? That's a disclaimer. Well, under the circumstances, but it's like, well, don't get under the circumstances. John 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but by me. So here you have this sheep pen that is either in a cave or next to a building or out. And you have all these boulders and rocks all the way around and thorns on the top, so thieves can't come in, or robbers, and certainly wolves and other things like that. And then you have an opening right here in front of it. And Jesus says, I am the gate. And so he as the shepherd lays down in front on the gate. And the only way into the pen or out of the pen is through the shepherd. Get that? That's a really awesome picture. And so he is the protector of the flock. He protects them so no one can come in and hurt the flock. He is also the provider, and it's through him on the way out, because the provision is out there, the protection is in here, and he's the gate. And we call, in the church, we call under-shepherds. We as pastors and elders are under-shepherds of the great shepherd. And it's, so it's our responsibility, directed by God, to protect the flock, but also to provide for the flock. That's hard to do. And it can be extremely rewarding. As this week, someone came to Christ I share the gospel with him, and they're not here today, but I'd give him a project to do. I shared the gospel and wasn't ready, and I said, well, where do you want to go from here? He said, well, what do I do next? I said, well, you need to read the Bible. You need to start with the book of Mark, read a chapter a day, take notes, and ask questions. When you get done with Mark, go into John, read a chapter a day. So I called him this week. I said, how you doing? He goes, Pastor, he says, I've been reading my Bible. There's a lot of stuff I didn't know. But he says, now that I'm a Christian, I said, what? He says, oh, yeah, he says, I became a Christian. He says, I get it. I thought, how exciting is that? It's the Word of God. You need to be in your Bible. I can't do it for you. I can't. I don't really want to do it for you, because you'd miss the blessing. We have a need of provision. And he has the ability to give us abundant life. Not just life, not just getting by, but abundant life. In the context of sheep, there's books written on this, which are very interesting. Sheep are totally helpless. They have no means of self-defense. Think about it. They're subject to stampeding. They're given to endless wanderings. They're more timid than stubborn, and they've been known to walk into fires. Not so good. They really need a shepherd. Sometimes people do that same thing. They return to doing stuff that's not so good, and they need a shepherd to whack them. Say, stop it. Come to grips with where you are. Our fourth principle, our need is protection. And his response is self-sacrifice. He talks about himself being the gate. Look at 11 to 13. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. And then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. The issue is that the shepherd cares for the sheep. It's not just a job, but he actually cares for the sheep. Loves the sheep. That's what the shepherd does. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Hear this, lay down. Five times in these eight verses, he mentions he lays down his life. Verse 16, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too listen to my voice, and there should be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my accord. I have the authority to lay it down and the authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. He says he's the shepherd. And so you got the flock that's in here, And you got the shepherd laying there, and he lays down his life for the sheep. You ever lay down your life for somebody else? I mean, obviously we have people in the police and emergency services and military. They lay down their life for us. But sometimes as a parent or grandparent, you lay down your life for your kids or your grandkids. You lay down your life when they're in trouble, or they need help financially, or they're sick and you stay up all night to talk with them or help them and hold them. Spend time listening to them and their needs. You pray for them when you can't do anything else. You lay down your life for them. Many parents work multiple jobs to provide for their family. Sometimes you go out because there's a bee after your kids, and you go and you squash the bee, and you take the bee by your own hand if you have to protect the child. You'll suffer your own pain. Why? Because you're there to protect. That's what he does for us. That's the kind of God I want to be a part of. He lays down his own life. John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down his life for his friends. And finally, the last principle is this, is our need is relationship, and his response is, he knows us. He says, my sheep hear my voice, they know me. And we want to live an independent life. A lot of times we see the pen, you know, that we're in, and we look, instead of enjoying being in the pen with the other sheep, all we see is the boundaries of this pen, and we get frustrated at the shepherd. It's like, all I see is walls. What do you mean you're trying to protect me? I feel like you're hemming me in. Well, that's part of what he does. There's one last picture I want to show. There's a picture I saw when I was a kid, a similar one to this, and it's Christ knocking on the door of your life. This is a good shepherd. And it's there's versions of this, but it's him being in the garden. And he's knocking on this door. And the thing, when you look at the door, there's something missing, which is what? There's no door handle or doorknob. He can't open the door. Then why is he doing that? He's doing that because he wants to come in, because you're inside. And the only way he can come in is you open the door. Revelation 3:20 says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in with him or her and eat with them. I'll have fellowship with them, but you have to open the door. That's a great illustration of the shepherd. And if you don't know Jesus, boy, you need to. You need to come to Christ and say, you know what? I've been out on my own for a long time. I've been independent. I've been doing my own thing. But I need the Savior, the shepherd, to come in and deal with me. You need to say, dear Lord, I admit that I've run my own life independent of you. But I am so grateful that you died for me. And he says he lays down his life. He's giving a picture, word picture of what he does on the cross. He lays down his life on the cross, and he dies for us, you and me. And he pays for our way. And you go, oh my goodness, he laid down his life. And he says, no one tells me to lay down my life. I choose to lay down my life, and I will choose to raise it again. That's the kind of God that I want. That's the kind of God that I want. That's the same God that remembers my name. Hundreds of billions of stars remembering their name, but he knows my name, and he knows yours too. Everyone, and he loves them. Everyone has value. Have you come to Christ? Are you living for Christ? Let's pray. Father, what an awesome privilege we have of studying the Scriptures and you laying it out for us in front of us. Jesus saying that he is the great shepherd. He is the door. He lays down his life. We are grateful. And for anyone who hasn't come to Christ, it's simple like this. Dear Lord Jesus, I am so grateful to hear that you love me and that you laid down your life on the cross for me when I could not save myself. You heard my cry. And I accept you and what you've done for me on the cross to pay my sin. I'm sorry for my sin. But I believe you paid for that. You died, was buried, and rose again to prove you're God. And one day you'll come back for me. I ask you to change my life forever. In Christ's name I pray that. Amen. It's been a good day this morning. Just a minute. My trust is that you will say, how can I enjoy being part of the flock, having a relationship with the shepherd who lays down his life for me? How can I share that with other people? And I pray that you can do that with joy, with vision, with hope. And there are other things to be involved to show your faithfulness. We're still doing this great project at the end of this month now, called Neighbor Reach. If you want to be a part of that and say, I want to serve and have opportunity to give, share my faith with others, you can sign up at the back table. I believe, Marsha, are you there today, or do you have? Okay. Right now we have 340 people from the churches that have signed up to say we want to be a part of that. And I think that's awesome. So why don't you all stand up, shake somebody's hand, and say, glad to have you here. Good day.